Try to scream. Everyone feeling okay? I'm Sierra. It's nice to kind of meet you all. I am a girl. I'm just dressed like a boy. But we're going to sing one more song tonight. It's called No Pressure. And in life, we're under pressure from so many things. Family, school, friends, and even like the sins that we've committed that stick with us, that make us feel really bad. Pressure from those. But the song talks about how God wants to take all of that off of us. He wants to just carry our burdens for us, take our sin away, and He wants to take the pressure off of us.
God, when you draw near, you change the atmosphere. There's no shame anymore. The sin that held my heart, you have lifted off.
Amazing.
Yeah, you're good. What's up, Brazil?
Yo.
How are we feeling tonight? Woo. So good.
That was amazing.
That was awesome. Woo. You guys are looking so good in your costumes. I'm loving what I'm seeing. It's my first Halloween, so I'm like really excited about this.
They don't have Halloween in New Zealand?
No, it's hide your kids, hide your wife kind of moment in New Zealand. But here, it's so cool. It's a party. I'm loving it.
Okay, guys. Thank you so much for coming to Risen Fear Factor. Guys, As you know, it's Halloween, everyone's dressed up, and we appreciate that. We really do. So we want to give back to you, but only if you've dressed the best. So what we have is a costume contest.
Let's go.
So we have sent some people to go scout out, find some costumes that they're like, dang, they did a good job, or dang, they look good, or like, dang, they're scary. They're scary. So I have the names right on my phone here. And the categories go as best individual. So if you're all alone, you'll find
like
someone
me.
Eventually. And then if the duo, so your best friend, girlfriend, your boyfriend, or best group.
That one's
hard because you gotta communicate, do all that. But when I call your name, I need you to run up on this stage and we're gonna get you to model your costume a little bit. So I'm gonna say the first one, which is best individual
best
costume.
Best individual. Let's
so,
go.
If you're in the room, hopefully you are, because that would be really awkward. The person who has the best individual costume is Roman, who is a steampunk. Can we give it up for Roman? Come up on
Let's
the stage,
go.
Buddy.
Come on upstage, Roman, buddy.
There he is. There he is. Let's
Check
give him a
hand. Him out.
Come on up here. Come on up here.
Come on up, man.
Ooh, dang, dude. We got you. Hype him up. Hype him up.
Let's go. Check him out. Dude, dang, where'd you get your outfit from?
I just made it. Homemade, yeah.
Homemade, guys. Wow. I'm
All
hitting
right,
you
so can you just
today.
Model it right here? Can you just give us a little twirl?
Give us
a
little twirl.
Oh, dang. Oh. Dude. Oh, yeah.
Fire. Woohoo.
Okay, buddy. For that, you win a champion sweater, my friend.
Yes.
If it's too big, this is what you use to go get something smaller or something bigger.
We
so
can just
give
get
it
the
up
money
for
back.
Roman.
And find something you want.
Go on down.
Alrighty.
Alright.
Now we got our best duo. Boom. So Jamie.
I want you to just say these names here.
Alright, so our best duo is Justin and Emily, who have come as Jughead and Betty.
Oh, Woo-hoo! Where are you guys at? Oh, there they are. Give them
if you
a
don't
hand,
know who that is,
hand.
It's from Riverdale.
Dang.
It's getting a little
Riverdale,
bit spiritual.
Still going.
Let's
okay,
go.
Guys. For doing that.
You guys have won yourself a date night.
You guys
Wait,
get
are
a
you guys
Cineplex
together?
Gift card right here. So go take her out on a good date. Go yeah. have her just spoil her, man. Spoil her. They want to be appreciated, so appreciate it. Okay, everyone, let's give them a hand. Head on back.
So good.
All right. Now, we have the last and maybe greatest McDonald's gift cards. Four. The groups. So who do you think won, Courtney?
Oh.
I think there's a lot of people.
I think there's a lot of people in groups tonight, and I think you guys are all looking pretty good, but at the end of the day, our scouts have the last say. So.
Yes, we didn't choose this. Some other people did. So, the best group, they came up with this, I don't know how long ago, but I have to say it's pretty smart. The best group goes to Colette, Jesse, Marin, Cassia, and Ashley for dressing up as our risen leader.
Yes!
So, come
What's
on up,
up
here,
homies?
come on up here.
Let's go.
I'm going to get them to name who they are. And if you've been at Risen long enough, you know who these people are. So, Marin, who are you?
I'm Noelle, Dr. Nemeth.
She's Noelle. That's one of our great leaders here. He's gonna be a doctor, so if you need help, go to him. And then, Jesse, what are you?
I'm Adam Mills!
She is Adam Mills.
Woo! Woo!
All right, and now what are you, Cassia?
I am Kendall. If you need to help with any volunteering things, come find me. I will tell you what to do.
She just did a Kendall right there. That was pretty good. If you know Kendall,
right.
You know that was pretty
Colette,
good.
Colette, who are you,
All
man?
Right, all right. Colette, who are you?
Yo, my name's Christian. Go Pittsburgh Penguins!
That is very much Christian. If you've ever been to Risen Camp, you know what I'm saying. And then Ashley, who are you?
I'm the one who does all the amazing videography. I'm Jamie.
Get out
That's
of here,
me, but that was great. So guys, you win the $10 McDonald's gift cards. You guys have to share it though, because there's five of you. Get off
You guys
the stage.
Are awesome.
Get off.
So good. All right, guys, we're gonna jump into our game. So we have four contestants that are gonna make their way on stage. They already know who they are. But while they come up and get ready, I just wanna say, if you're new in this place tonight, we wanna welcome you here in this place. Tonight is for you. Risen is not as like a once a month kind of thing that happens. Oh yeah, it's a Risen night that happens once a month, sorry. But more than that, we also run something every week, every single day of the week, so that you can fit it into your schedule. And that is our YCGs. Do we have?
Yeah!
Let's go. On a honestly, YCGs, if you don't know what they are our Youth Connect groups. That's where you guys want to come along. You want to build lifelong friendships. That's actually where you build lifelong friendships. It's so good. You dive in deep into the Word of God, and you also learn how to do life together and journey together. It's so dope. I love it.
All right, so as these guys are getting ready, I'm going to explain the game to you guys. We've already prepped these guys. They know what's going on.
They already know what they're doing.
As you see, they've got some rain jackets on. But as you can see, we have some lovely tomato sauce. So it's a little bit fear factor. We got to keep some gross stuff in here. So we got some tomato sauce, and inside this tomato sauce,
and
ain't apples, it's onions. So that's pretty gross. So what they have to do is they have to bob for onions, but they can only go one at a time because they're handcuffed back to back. So what's going to happen is one of them is going to bob, grab the onion, put it in this bowl. And then from there, once they have grabbed nine onions. They have to go right over here. Me and Courtney are gonna give them a piece of paper and it has a person, place, thing on it. They have to draw it on the Pictionary board and get it. And if they get it, the other person has to draw. So, they can only do it with their mouth though, because they ain't got no hands. So, are you guys ready? They're ready. All right, can we count them down in three, two, one. Go! Come on, let's go. Grab it, woo! Put it right in there. Okay, next one.
Dang,
next
we
one,
got one over here.
Girls,
let's go.
You gotta hype right, it up for the girls.
Switch over,
here.
No, it's next person.
Oh, whoa. I got you. Go.
Let's go.
That's gross.
We got two in this bowl already.
Go back.
Alright, then switch, bro.
Don't care.
Woo! There's like holes in the goggles, so it's like poking in their eyes.
You got it. Oh, that is gross. Ooh. The girl's got one onion. The guys look like they're going. Okay, grab it. Here.
Switch.
I'll put it in. Go.
Let's go.
Okay, there you go. Come on.
Let's get it down.
Get it down. Girls, need to hype them up again. I think they need a little support.
Get in there, bro.
They need a little support. Come on. Ooh,
keep
that
those hands behind your back,
gross.
Yo.
Okay, next.
Nice. All right, we got two more, guys. Two more.
I'm getting sick just smelling it right here. Okay, next one. Man, the girls are crushing it. Ooh, the guys look like they're going pretty good. Courtney, make sure you get ready with a marker for them. What's all right? Okay, you guys need four,
five
more.
Listen to
you guys
need
five. The guys are already onto the Pictionary. Come on, guys. Four more. You guys got it. Let's go.
Oh, you're actually doing a pretty good job.
You guys are not hyping up your girls. Oh, my gosh. Okay, that's fine.
Bro, this guy's taking it serious.
He's going for details. You got two more.
Bro, just that.
You got two more for the girls. Dang, get in there. One more. That's only a piece. You gotta grab it all. All right. Come over here. So I'm gonna give you this, and now draw that. Okay, so once you've drawn that, turn around.
We just had to start again because he thought.
Keep going.
Okay. You know what that is?
All right. Turn around. What is it?
A flower.
Not a flower.
Stay alive.
More detail. You got this. Okay. Go now.
A girl.
Yes. There you go. Okay. Give me that marker. Okay, you grab it.
What is it?
Now it's your turn. All right. Now draw that. 1 second.
Yes! We have a winner! Bro,
they just guessed it.
Yeah.
Oh, they won! Girls, you have sadly lost. That is okay.
Let's go.
Give a hand to
draw a pumpkin.
Teams. All right. So now, head on out over there. I am losing
head
my
on
voice.
Off, guys.
Holy cow.
That was
give
hella
a hand
messy,
for
bro.
Our contestants here.
Give it up for this side.
Ooh, that was good.
They killed it.
Ooh.
Bro, it was smelling pretty saucy.
I'm losing my voice already.
Yeah, it seems a bit dry upstage.
I'm just going. Anyways, guys, if you can still hear me, YCGs. You guys heard about it. You guys know about it. We've told you already, but we just want to say it again. If you do not have a YCG, find one.
Yeah,
you can go
make
online,
sure you find one.
You can come out on a Sunday. And even we have a sign up for tonight in the Dome lobby right over there. So just be excited to go find some great friends. And what else is going on?
Yeah, tonight? Nice, Jamie. All right. Also, guys, we just want to take a moment real quick. If everyone could just put their hands together for every single person that helped to make tonight happen. Seriously. I popped in like a few like a few days, and honestly, it was just students. Students were coming after school, staying late till night, making this happen for you guys. This is your friends, guys, that put this on for you. They deserve amazing praise. So when you see them, if you know who they are, just thank anyone. Just say thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for putting this on. It's a dope show. But anyway, before Jamie explains about Next Risen next month, there's a dude who's going to be coming up and speaking with us tonight, and he is literally the coolest dude ever. He is going to literally blow your mind. Now, he tells some pretty lame jokes, but other than that, he is a man of depth, a man of character, a man who will challenge you. So when he gets up to speak, I encourage you guys, if you're new in this place, if you're old, if you're just whatever, sit on the edge of your seats. Be open to what God is going to say through him, because he's literally going to change your world. But Jamie.
Okay, guys, so again, right before that, we have a video to share with you, because next month we have Risen Night again. Woo! So this doesn't just happen at Fear Factor, anything like that. If this is your first time, we do this thing every single month. And we have a theme, we got free food every month, and we got a bunch of great things. So our theme for next month is going to be shown in this video here. So November 23rd, write it down in your calendars, put it in your Snapchat, I don't know, Instagram, and be like,
make sure you're there.
23rd, I'm ready. So what we're going to be doing is watching the Sasquatch.
This is what I've been preparing for since I rolled out of the womb. This is not a battle. This is a war.
Man, I was born for this. I didn't choose this challenge. This challenge chose me.
Basically, what it comes down to is I'm the best. There's nobody other than Lil E.T.
I've been putting in time, putting in work. I didn't choose this challenge. This was my destiny to fulfill this challenge.
People come up to me all the time telling me I'm the next Kanye West. And my response is always, Kanye who?
This is game season. I am a champion. Call me Floyd Mayweather, okay? Juicy J comes ready for the battle.
Juicy J has begged me to collab with him. And you know what I said? No.
Listen here, Lil E.T. My plan is simple. I'm going to wipe the floor with you. It's not even a competition.
Juicy J, you fear success, but you have nothing to worry about.
Welcome to Fear Factor! We are so excited you are here. I can't wait for the rap battle that's happening in about a month from today. It's going to be so good. I'm wondering just off the bat who thinks Lil E.T. is going to take it. All right. Where's all the Juicy J people? All right. We'll have to see. Maybe we'll have to get up on the Instagrams and the Snapchats and the social medias of the world and be hyping it up, seeing who we think's gonna win over the next month. It's gonna be good. It's wet up here. It stinks up here. And most of you guys look good tonight. There's a few that are questionable, but for the most part, we got a pretty good crowd tonight. We're so thankful you're here at Fear Factor. Whose first time is it at Fear Factor? Whose very first time? Come on, can we give it up for these people? This is around, I don't know exactly how long, but it's around my 10th year at Fear Factor. When I start talking about Risen events, I start eclipsing that 10-year mark. So is there any second Fear Factors out there? Second time? Third times? Who's been here four times? Five? Six? Seven. I know Katie, wait, is there any students? Is there any students that have been here seven times? Six times, where's the six-time students at? There's one. Hey, I don't know if we can get him a prize or nothing, but can we get Jordan a prize later for just being dope? Just get him one. I don't know how we're gonna do that, or I didn't plan that part. Let's just do it. Let's just get him something, because it's dope. We've been doing this for many years, and we absolutely love Fear Factor. So thanks for everybody dressed up. Shout out to the group that dressed up like some of the best-looking Risen leaders that we've ever had. Leave it at that. Some of you tonight think I didn't dress up. Some of you think I didn't dress up, but little do you know, I'm dressed like Carl Lentz. And if you don't know who Carl Lentz is, that's because you're not into the church world, and that's completely okay with me. We'll get you there. It's a church joke, and they're lame. It's fine. We're going to be in this room. We're going to be in this room together for the next 20, 25 minutes. And what I ask of you is three things, just three things. It's simple. Simple. I ask you to laugh because church shouldn't be boring. Thank you, Katie White. I ask you to listen because God wants to speak to you tonight. Some of you came to Fear Factor thinking it's just a costume party or it's just a party in general. And again, I'm completely cool with that. I'm glad you're in the room, but I have something to tell you that God wants to speak to you tonight. God wants to speak to the people around you, but he wants to speak to you tonight. So don't discount the fact that you're sitting in the room tonight. And three, I want you to lean in. Because we don't sit back on things that are exciting. We don't sit back for things that are, some people are like, oh God, he actually wants me to. Yeah, lean forward. You don't sit back at a hockey game. You don't sit back at a, well, maybe at a movie if it's a boring movie. But you lean in, and I believe that God's going to work tonight. So what we're going to do is we're going to pray, and then we're going to chat for the next 20 minutes. Lord, would you have your way in the room tonight? God, we thank you that you've brought every single person here. Lord, we thank you for anybody watching on the live stream, wherever they may be. God, we're so thankful that you're going to speak to every single one of these people in the room tonight. Lord, use this message and use my life. In Jesus' name, we say it. Amen. Have you guys, I know the answer to this already, but have you guys ever made a decision in the moment that when you looked back on it, you realized it was dumb? Anyone in the room? Everyone in the room. When I was sitting down, I was planning my message out tonight. I was looking at what story do I tell? So I asked my wife. I said, "Hey Maria, do I have a story where I did something dumb when I made a decision and then I looked back on it and realized it was dumb?" You want to know her response? She said, "Just pick one. You have thousands." And I'm like, "Excuse me. That's rude and mean and hurtful." And true. But I narrowed it down and I started to think about Halloween. And there's two types of trick-or-treaters out there. How many of you guys are still gonna go trick-or-treating this year? Come on, don't be ashamed. Hey, I'm at the age now where it's 100% inappropriate for me to go trick-or-treating. But I have a 2-year-old. And it is 100% appropriate for him to go trick-or-treating, but it is also 100% inappropriate for him to eat all the candy. So I'm gonna help him out. That's why you have kids, people. That's why you have kids. And chores. That's the other reason. Chores and free candy. But there's two types of trick-or-treaters in this world. There's the type, like, I was the kind of guy who, like, trick-or-treating wasn't like a fun thing we did. It was like a mission. It was a job. I got a job to do tonight, and if you're with me, we're running. We're hitting multiple neighborhoods. We're mapping this baby out, and we're going to feast for weeks. Then there's the people that are like, yeah, it's fun, it's cool, it's great. We'll grab some candy and then we'll eat it. What I would do when I get home, I was the pillow sack guy, the pillowcase guy. I didn't have time for a bucket or a bin, too small. I had a pillowcase. I would run and I would fill my pillowcase up and I would get home. And maybe you're like me, you get home and the first thing you do is you dump it out. You start sorting through it. I got chips. I got the weird like bags that like you think are dope, but then you open it and it's like a candy outside of a wrapper, and you're like, I can't eat this. Like, you got the chocolate bars, you got the candies, you got the smart, like you got the whole deal. I was the kind of guy that back in the day I didn't know Jesus yet, so I didn't like Reese cups. My sister loved Reese cups, so we would make trades. I would say, I don't want my Reese cups. And I traded for O. Henry's, which again, looking back, one of those decisions, like you gave up a Reese cup for an O. Henry, just like you could have made a better decision. And I understand that now, but we would trade, we'd make trades. And then what I would do is I would eat as much candy as I could. Is there anyone else out there that on Halloween night, you would just consume as much candy as you could? You're like me. My wife is the complete opposite. She would separate, she would do the whole thing, but then she would eat one candy. She said it would last her till Christmas. I'm like, Christmas? It's like 2 months away. There ain't no way that's lasting until Christmas. I always think I would consume it all. But here's what I realized about consuming it all. It was fun now, but looking back, it was a dumb decision. Because you get the stomach ache, you get the sugar rush headache, plus you don't have any candy anymore. So it's a dumb decision when I look back. What's the saying we all know? Hindsight is 20/20. Hindsight's 20/20. All it's saying is when you have a different perspective or when you have more information, you can see it from a different angle and you can make a better decision about the situation. That's hindsight 20/20. That's what it's like for me in my chocolate. In the moment, I'm like, I just want to, Then I step back. Some of you tonight are going to get free candy and that's who you're going to be. And I'm going to walk around and be like, yo, what's up? Hey, that's me. Have you ever been in a situation where looking back on it, it offered new information? You look back on a situation and you go, if I just would have known now or what I know now back then, I could have made a different, it could have looked a little bit different. We've all been in situations like this. I'm a Seahawks fan. I love my football, which is why Jesse was wearing the best jersey you'll ever see. Go Hawks. Thank you. I don't know who that was, but appreciate you. The Lord is with you. I love football, and I love watching live sports because you don't know what's happening. You're going to be in the middle of it, and you just want to know how it ends. There'll be games where I'm standing up like, you think I'm joking? Missed the kick. And I'm also the guy that will PVR live sports and watch it later. But then I know the score, and I watch it anyways, and it's just not as fun. Because when I know the information, when I know the outcome, it's way different than walking through it from the get-go. So when you have more information, when you can make a different decision, It's we've all had situations. Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's a movie you've watched and you're in the middle of a movie and you're like, I just want to know how it ends. Then you watch how it ends and you're like, oh, okay, cool. Or if you go with the weebs go to the movie before you, they'll tell you all about it before the movie shows you what's happening. Skip the movie with the weebs if they've seen it already. They talk through the whole thing. It's not good. It's not fun. If they haven't seen it, go with them. But if they've seen it already, skip it with them. Just go alone. Go alone. You've been in relationships where you're like, is this going to work out? I just want to know how this ends. Does it end in heartache? Or does it end in like a happy, fun, where we're married? We can all relate to a decision where we, looking back on it, we could have made a better decision if we just had a little bit more information. If we knew how it ended now, it would be easier. There's a story in the Bible I want to talk to you about tonight. It's about some siblings. And there's two girls. They're Mary and Martha. And they have a brother. His name's Lazarus. And Lazarus is getting sick. Now, this sibling trio is friends with Jesus. They've had a couple encounters with Jesus, so they know him. They kind of know his character. They know how great he is. They know the miracles that he can do. And so Jesus is off in one area, and they're off in the other area, and Lazarus gets sick. And Lazarus is getting, he's sick, but it's not just like oh, I'm sick, like a guy typically does. It's like a real sick. It's like there's a chance that I die sick. And so Mary and Martha, they go, and then they call for Jesus. And they just want Jesus to come and be with Lazarus and help their situation, help their sick brother. So they send for Jesus. They ask, hey, Jesus, can you come here and help us? Jesus is with his homies. Jesus is with his 12 disciples. And he says this in verse, it's in John 11, verse 4, and he says this. He says, when he heard this, the news about Lazarus, Jesus said, this sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. So, we know the situation. We know the story. Lazarus is sick. Lazarus is dying. Mary and Martha, they send for help. Hey, Jesus, can you come and help? And Jesus right there gives you and I the answer to the question. Does Lazarus die? Jesus says he does not die. This will not end in death. So Jesus is like, it's all good. We can take our time getting there. They want me to come now. We're going to wait a few days. So they keep doing their thing. And Mary and Martha are standing in the situation. They're in the middle of a circumstance where their brother is sick. The sickness leads to Lazarus dying. But I thought you said, Jesus, we'll get there. So they're in the middle of a situation now where Lazarus has died. The sickness has got to such a place where Lazarus is dead, and Jesus isn't here. Jesus has not said anything. Jesus has not said, yeah, I'm on my way, just wait a few days. He's not said anything, and he's not shown up, and now Lazarus is dead. So they're in the middle of a situation. They're in the middle of mourning the loss of their brother. They're in the middle of a loved one passing away. They're in the middle of those few days where you don't really know what's going on, where tragedy hits you like a brick, and then it's like, what do I do? This is their reality. This is what they're feeling. This is how they're reacting and responding in this moment, because they don't know, like you and I know, that Jesus is going to come. They think he's not coming. How do they know? Jesus isn't here now. He didn't save him. He didn't heal him. This is where they're at. They're in the middle of a literal dead situation. Their brothers passed away, and they're in full mourning. What do they do? Where do you go? If Jesus would have just told me, if he would have just let me know that he's going to come, I could be a little bit different, but he didn't. And now I'm stuck in a situation. Now I'm stuck in a dead situation. You and I, when I'm reading the story, I'm like, hey, Mary, Martha, bro. Girls, it's all good. Hey, it's all good. Jesus is coming. It's all good. But from my perspective, because I know the entire story, I can say that. I can say, no, it's all good. It's fine. He's going to come. He's on his way. Trust me, he'll be here. But they don't know that. They can't feel that. They're stuck. They're in the middle of a situation. So 4 days, Lazarus is dead for 4 days. And then Jesus is like, hey, look who's here. Where's Laz? Huh? Where is he? Huh? You say he's sick. Where is he? Mary and Martha come up to him and they tell him, hey, Jesus, he's dead. He's dead. They say this statement in 2 separate times in this story. Both Mary and Martha, they both say the exact same statement. They say, Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. That's where they're at, Risen. If you would have been here, he wouldn't be dead. If you would have been here, this is not the situation we'd be standing in, Jesus, but you didn't show up. If you would have been here, the situation looks different. But you and I know it's all good. Jesus already told us it doesn't end in death. It doesn't end. The sickness doesn't win. But they don't know that. They can't feel that. That's the reality. That's where they're at. You and I could get to situations like that, can't we? Man, if you'd have just been here. If you'd have been here, blank wouldn't have happened to me. If you would have been in my life, this wouldn't have happened. This person wouldn't have done that. I wouldn't have gone into this situation. If you would have been here when I asked you to, they would still be alive today. If you would have been here, blank. You and I get in the same situations. Jesus, if you just would have been here, this situation would look way different. So Jesus goes, okay, ladies, bring me to the tomb. I want to go see Laz. I want to go see Laz. So they walk over, take him to the tomb. And back in the day, they had these big, like, basically it's like a big cave that they brought him to. And it's a big stone in the way of the burial, whatever they call it. It's basically at a graveyard. And Jesus, the Bible says something about Jesus that I absolutely love. It shows you so much of Jesus' character in such a small little verse. From what I understand, the shortest scripture in the Bible, it's in this story. It's also the easiest one to remember for all you guys out there that need a scripture on the top of your head. This is the one for you. It says, Jesus wept. Jesus wept. Jesus puts himself in the situation. Jesus already knows the answer. Jesus knows this doesn't end in death. But he puts himself beside Mary and Martha that are going through absolute hell on earth. And he cries with them. He weeps with them. This is our God. To put himself in a situation with people. To put himself side by side with you and I in whatever you're going through. and going, I know this hurts right now. I know that whatever you're going through right now, you don't feel like you can get out of. I know that this looks dark. I know that this hurts. And he's sitting there with them crying. And then he gets up and he says, hey, let's roll that stone away. Let's roll the stone away. Mary says something I think is hilarious. She says, okay, Jesus, we could do that. But don't you think it's going to stink? I want to say to Mary, yeah, he's been dead for 4 days. Of course it's going to stink. You don't think he knows that? Duh. Jesus says, let's roll it away. Let's roll it away. I want to show you guys something. Roll it away. Jesus, then he prays. And in his prayer, he says, like, God, I already know what's going to happen. You already know what's going to happen. But I'm going to pray so that the people around me know what's going to happen. And then he does something that's unbelievable. This dude's been dead for 4 days. And he goes, Lazarus! Come out. Laz! Hey, homie, hey. Come on out here. Come out. And all of a sudden, a straight up, like, old school zombie with the stuff on his, not like the Walking Dead creepy, like, disease, but like a straight up old zombie. He literally walks out with the burial cloth still on him. 4 days. And Jesus was right. From the get-go, Jesus was right. He said, this is not going to end in death. Sickness does not win. But in the moment, they couldn't see it. Which makes complete sense to me. Because they didn't know what Jesus knew. They're in the middle of a situation. They're in the middle of their dead situation. All they knew is their brother was sick. All they knew is that the sickness ended in death. And all they knew was the hurt that came from it. They didn't know what Jesus was going to do. You and I knew because we read it. This brings me to this window that's been behind me this whole time. I was standing in my living room, and I have a window that's much larger than this one in my living room. And I was standing, I don't even know what I was doing. I was standing at the window, and we have one of those neighborhood mailboxes. And it's right out front of our house. And I was standing there, and I was watching people get their mail. I'm 26, and I got a 2-year-old, guys. What do you want me to do? I don't know. Watching these people get their mail, and I'm watching them walk into my window frame, and I'm watching them walk out of my window frame. And I felt God put this message in my heart that you don't know what's happening before, but you also don't know what's happening after. All you see now is what you see through the window. You don't know where those people are going. You don't know what's happened in their life to get them to where they are today. And I felt like God put this message on my heart. That you and I are going through things, Risen, where all we see is our window. All we see is what's dead in front of us right now. You and I get to the place where Mary and Martha are, where all they see is Lazarus sick in front of them. All they see is Lazarus dead in front of them, but they don't know what's happening outside the window frame. They don't know what God's going to do. And you and I can get to these situations where we're here, and we get stuck here sometimes. This is where Mary and Martha were. This is where their mourning happened, because they knew what took place here. Let me do it this side for you guys. They knew what happened here before the window frame. They knew that the sickness took them to the place of now death, but they don't know what's going to happen here. We need a perspective change, people. That although our situation looks dead now, that although it looks like there's no ending, that all we see is hurt, that all we feel is pain, that all we can think about and fathom is the thing that's right in front of us right now, there's a future for you still. And God's the one that's going to write the story. There was more to the story than what they could see through their window. God moved after the window. Jesus changed their life after their window. And he wants to do the same for you. We get stuck here because this is comfortable, because this is what we can see, this is what we know, and we get stuck here. But just because you can't see God moving doesn't mean he's not moving. Just because you don't feel God moving doesn't mean he's not moving. Just because this looks bad doesn't mean God's not planning something for your future. Over here, way over here in the story, Mary and Martha, he says, it's fine, guys. Your window situation that looks dead isn't going to end in death. It's fine. What's God saying to you? What dead situation is God already declared it's not ending in death? But we're over here, and all we can see is that situation. All we can feel is that brokenness. Maybe it's a dream that you had that all you can see is the dead dream that didn't happen. You wanted to make a team, or you wanted to be a part of something and it didn't happen. Maybe you wanted a happy family and it's not happening. Maybe you feel like there's an academic pressure on your life and all you can see is that pressure. Maybe it's a sport for you. Maybe it's a club for you. And all you can see is the pressure and the stress and the weight of what's happening here. Maybe you're feeling alone right now. Even though you're surrounded by 250 people, you're feeling alone. Maybe your friends have tried to reach out to you, but you're feeling alone, and all you can see now is the dead situation that's standing in front of you. Maybe you're battling depression. Maybe you're struggling with anxiety, and all you can see is the pressure. All you can feel is the emotion. And we're stuck at our window. And in these moments, we can feel just like Mary and Martha. We can feel just the way they did, hopeless. It's dead. My brother's dead. It's over. Where were you, Jesus? If you'd have been here, this would not be dead. But we need to realize that the same perspective that you and I had of this story is the same perspective we need to have of our story. The story's not done with the window. The story's not done with the tomb. Jesus rolled it away, and he wants to do the same in your life. I don't know what's dead in your life right now, Risen. I don't know what you feel is dead in your world right now. If it's a relationship, it's one of those things we talked about. We listed at the window. I don't know what it is for you. But I know that being a teenager is tough. And I can't imagine what being a teenager in 2018 is like. You guys are going through real stuff. You're going through real pain. But your story's not done yet. This does not end in death. Some of you in here tonight need to make a decision for Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Because it's going to shift your perspective. It's going to shift your perspective to see that our God's bigger than your situation. It's going to shift your perspective to see that our God is bigger than that circumstance. It's going to shift your perspective off of the window to realize that our God's bigger than your stress, that our God's bigger than your fear, that our God's bigger than your doubt, that our God's bigger than your anxiety, that our God's bigger than them. Whatever you're going through now, our God is bigger and he's going to change your future. And we need to make a perspective change. Can we bow our heads and close our eyes? We got free candy to give away. We got a dope haunted house to run through. We got a dance party to get at. But nothing more important tonight is going to happen than what's happening right here, right now. Tonight, some people are going to make a decision to say yes to Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Adam? It means that I'm just living my life from a different perspective. I don't know everything. I don't have it all together. That's fine. You don't need to. Romans 10 says it so simply, says that if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the grave, you will be saved. It's a belief in your heart and a declaration from your mouth that makes you right standing with Jesus. that gets you at a place where forgiveness is, where peace is, where you don't have to worry about your future anymore, because God's got you. You're going to go through trials. You're going to go through heartache. You're going to go through pain, but God's got you. And this does not end in death. Let's pray with every head bowed, every eye closed. If you want to make a decision tonight for Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life, on the count of three, I'd just love to see your hands slip up, touch the ceiling. You can't actually, but make it like you can. One, two, three. Hands up across the room. If you want to make a decision to make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life, hands in every section of this room. We can put your hands down. Now, Risen, I would love for you to pray with me as we support the people making the best decision of their life. Say, Jesus, thank you so much for dying on a cross and paying for my sins. Today I declare that you are Lord, that you are my Savior, and I have a perspective change today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.